magnificent and great Elijah. You guys are the reason that we're here in the first place, so please do line up. Great, I have not had the pleasure, the honor, the privilege of being on a stage with you. One of the not only most prolific, but most incredibly gifted voice actors and now stand-up comedians that we have in business. How far back does performing go for you? Have you wanted to be a performer ever since you were a kid? Is it something that the bug bit you or?
Absolutely. My very first project, my given name is Erin Gray, Delisle, so I went by Erin when I was little, and when I went to preschool, they had our first initial, and they said to decorate it and make it into a job. So mine was Erin the Entertainer, and I decorated this big E, you know, and that's funny because I never did, I'm not just, I mean, I'm definitely an entertainer, I don't call myself an actor.
But you're so much more than that.
I'm an entertainer. I saw a Michael Jackson impersonator on the plane once, and I was like, oh, I said, you're a Michael Jackson impersonator? And he was like, no, I'm a, he called it like some other thing, like a tribute artist. And I was like, oh, okay, I think
that's something. Another name, tribute.
There you go, yes, so, yes, interesting. But I mean, it's funny, because people, like, I do music stuff, and some people just know me for that, and then some people love the cartoon stuff, and I got stomped out my stand-up comedy the other day. Lady's like, I don't want to bother you. And I was like, oh, you're not bothering me. I've never been recognized for my stand-up before. I was telling him Patton Oswalt followed me on Twitter, and I was like all excited. I was like, you must have seen my stand-up. Then I was like, no, great. He just loves comic books and stuff. But yeah, it's all about the cartoons. So. For a second, I was like,
well, so many people in this room know you for your voice work, and everybody has a different voice acting origin story, I find. I mean, if you want to become a voice actor, there's a great website that Bradley Baker put together called iwanttobeaboiceactor.com. What are
you doing? I have sent so many people that because you answer the same questions over and over again, like, he covers it so well, and he doesn't charge money. There's people that I'm like, oh, you're taking advantage of people, you know? I mean, because, I mean, what if they're not good at it, and then they spend all this money already, and they don't, you know, no. So, if you're good or not, you'll get all the same answers I would give you. Because people are always like, I think you're brainy. Can I have coffee with you? And I'm like, I can't even have time. I don't have time to have coffee with people that I really know and want to have coffee. I have three children, so I don't have time for anything. So I'm always like, I can't, like, pick my brain up, but you can't go to this website. So.
But there's always some sort of a fascinating story. Folks of your stature in voiceover have the most crazy, you know, stumbling into it backwards, sideways, upside down kind of story of getting into it. How did you get into being a voice actor?
I always did voices from the time I was really little. Like, I would entertain my grandmother. My grandmother would raise me, this little Mexican woman, Eva Ruth, or Eva Flores, she had a white accent. She worked in a factory, and she got ready, I would learn the monologues and all the jokes from the Tonight Show and stuff the night before. I would get to stay up kind of late, and she would have to go to sleep because she had to get up really early, and I would get up and while she was doing her hair, I would do whatever, stand up or whatever, like voices, or just, I just made her laugh all the time, so. And of course, my grandmas just think you're the most amazing thing, no matter what. Like, I have like a false sense of security, so I love
going. What was her go-to phrase? I mean, you gave her one of these performances. What was that? I've heard you do her voice.
Yes, well, she actually got really mad at me once because she kept entering me in beauty pageants, which I had no interest in at all. I was this little girl, and she would do these horrible banana curls in my hair. And one time they asked, like, who's the biggest influence in your life? My grandma was sitting down and thinking, well, here we go. Here's my chance to be mentioned. I was like, Carol Burnett.
Aww.
And she was so mad, she would talk to her and go, I do everything for you and take care of you and feed you and they ask you who you love and you say this silly woman. I'm just so upset. A silly woman who scratches her butt all the time on the TV.
She was really having that kind of, you know, validating presence in your life and encouraging you to pursue the thing that so many people's caretakers parents, guardians tell them, oh God, please, can you just be a doctor? Can you just be a lawyer? Can you just do this? I mean, that had to be a real gift. I mean, what did that do for you as you were coming up through school?
Well, some people think that your parents should like prepare you for the world. You guys can do that. Their kids to the real world by like being kind of mean. I'm like, I gotta prepare them. They're gonna get criticized when they get out in the world. But my grandmother did the absolute opposite. Just told me how incredible I was. I wasn't, but I left thinking like I could. People could say anything to me in LA, which was a really hard town to move into because everybody tells you, oh, you're too fat. You're not even cute enough to be the friend. You know, I mean, just like awful things people tell you. And I didn't care. I was like, my grandma thinks I'm amazing. So thank you for your opinion, and I'm on to the next person. I mean, I just thought I was fantastic. None of the bad stuff got through,
yeah,
but, and I was told some pretty awful things.
So, you've got kids. Are you encouraging them in the same way, encouraging them along their lines of interests?
My daughter's only one. She's a little cute. She's really funny, but I can't really tell what her little leanings are going to be yet. My middle son is completely shy and hates like being photographed. His dad's very shy, so he just like hates to send her attention and hates all that. But my oldest is got the bug and bad. He's got like a YouTube channel texting him, and he does all kinds of characters and puts wigs on and does all kinds of crazy stuff. But he actually just got a big part. I can't tell you guys what it is, but it's a show that I'm on, and it's a really cool show, and we get to record together and go out and do things after we go to work.
It's officially a dynasty.
Well, I'm kind of counting on him to take care of me when I'm old. I was like, if you do conventions and I don't do them anymore, can I kind of come and like just help you be your handler? And he's like, yeah, Mom, I'll take care of you, don't worry.
No, I'm sorry, he's going to have his lunch in 3 years.
He just got a big giant video game, and he loves the video game. And I was like, oh my God, what is it? He's like, I can't really talk about it because I signed a confidentiality agreement. I'm like,
oh.
By the time he was 10, I'm like, you're 10 years old and I made you in my body. Can you tell me what the darn video game is?
I admire the professionalism, but...
We ran into the director and we saw the director together. We both worked with the guy, and then Texas like, I didn't, my mom asked me to tell her what that game was, and I didn't tell her. Texas, I'm pretty sure you can tell your mom.
You yourself have worked on so many fan-beloved properties. Are there any that you had an affection for, whether they were pre-existing properties that got rebooted or something like that were really near and dear to your heart when you got the gigantic NDA and contract and everything, you went, oh God, I get to play with this toy in the toy box, any of that kind of stuff?
I've gotten to do a lot of, old Hanna-Barbera voices, which have been amazing. First of all, Daphne was like a huge, even though...
the Daphnes that have come before are great and everything, but you really are the Daphne.
Well, Jeepers, thank you so much for saying that. I really appreciate it. And my mentor was Daphne right before me, and she had passed away, so it was kind of like a really sad thing when I got it. And I didn't even want to audition for it because I felt like, no, but it's my friend. And her husband was like, great, she loved you. If anybody should do it, it should be you because that's what she would have wanted. And I was like, oh, but I can hardly. And I couldn't think. They sent all these tapes to like voice match it, and I was like, there's no way I'm listening to that. I'm just going to go in there and just, if she wants me to have it, something will happen. And the engineer said, great, I got goosebumps. Like, you just sounded just like her. I said, I didn't try to match her. But you know, when you learn from someone, you know how you probably talk a lot like your best friend. When you're around somebody, you start to like have the same pattern. My friend, actually, my best friend, does voiceovers too. She's all the voices on South Park, April Stewart. She's great. But it's funny, when she first started, we talked. Our little voices were the same, like our patter and our little sense of humor and everything. And her first slogan was, champagne taste for your budget, April Stewart will knock you on your ass. Just like she was talking about, like if they wanted a Grammy, they couldn't get her, she would totally do it for cheaper. now she's. I'm doing Jane Jensen, and I'm doing Betty Rubble, which I've gotten to do a lot now. There's a series, it hasn't come out yet, but it's called Yabba Dabba Dinos, I think, and I'm doing that. And I'm just, it's so fun, but my biggest thing that I just got that I was like so freaking excited, I mean, you might not even know because I don't know if you guys go to Disneyland very often, but you know the pirate scene in Disneyland, you know they were selling the women, the human trafficking portion of the I know there are some purists out there who hate it, and I get that too. I can understand.
It's the same as it was in 1955.
I know, but I can get that to a certain extent because if they like change the TV room or something, I'd be like, oh, and that's kind of racist too. Like, yeah. Like, oh, I am Mexican, and I'm like, oh, that's
joke. My son kind of comes with me sometimes to you know, he likes to all this comic book stuff. And he went to see the Shanghai tunnels in Portland, and it was all about human trafficking. So we learned about human trafficking. And he was like, horrified. And so then we're on at Disneyland, and he's like, Mom, oh my gosh, is that, are they selling those people? Is that what they're doing? And they have to, he's like, Mr. Social Justice. So he's like, they have to change that. Disneyland, it can happen. And I said, I know, but we think you're really cranky about changing it. And we get the best response. He was like, if they can change it to put Johnny Depp on the ride, they can change it to take out the human trafficking. Yeah, that's probably true. Okay, just women, whatever. So anyway, they were replacing the redhead, and they made her into this like bootlegger who's got this rum, and she's selling the rum, and she's like a really badass pirate, and it was just so cool. So there were like this huge round of auditions, and I was like, wouldn't that be amazing? Like my kids, like my favorite ride in Disneyland and Disney World, and. Oh my god, my grandchildren will go on that ride, but that's my grandma's voice. And I got closer and closer and closer, and I was like, oh, please, please, please. And the funny thing is it would have been perfect for Mary Kay Bergman, who was my mentor, who used to play Daphne. She had a redhead, that was her favorite ride in the world, and she had like the album, and she was just like obsessed with that ride. So at the final audition, I was like, I talk to her all the time, like when I'm on auditions and stuff. And I was just like, Mary Kay, this is your spot, because she was the voice of Snow White. So she was always in Disney character voices, and that's where the callback took place. So I was there, and I was like, wow, I'm in Disney character voices, this is amazing. And I'm sitting in the lobby, and I was like, all right, Mary Kay, if you were here, what would you do? Because this probably should be your part, and you are the redhead, and you were the redhead. So, you know, what should I do? And I felt her say, like, you need to prepare, great, you never prepare. You know, and I don't. I'm always, like, flying by the seat of my pants. This is my high school boyfriend, Walter, and Maggie, and Max, and Harry, and so anyway. but so I'm sitting in the lobby, and so I'm like, okay, I'll prepare a little, and I go on. I was like, what should I do? I'm like, I'll look up pirate slang, and I looked up a bunch of pirate slang. I found out that eggs are called cackle fruit. There are all these like slang terms, and I thought I'm probably not gonna even need this. There was only like three lines for the girl, right? So I go in there, and they were like, you know what? This time, because they had me in before, and they're like, this time, you know, it's down to a few of you, so we're just gonna have you guys just improv some pirate stuff. And I was like, oh my god, thank you so much, Mary Kay, because I would have not known what to do with these three lines. I was like, oh, the cackle fruit, oh, it's an introduction of that. Mickey's Nug, I like had all the butter and stuff. And they're like, wow, you really know a lot about butter. So, 5 minutes before, so thank you, Mary Kay, and it's awesome. Oh, and the really neat thing is, I wrote to her husband and I said, I just auditioned for this thing that Mary Kay would have been perfect for, and I'll tell you about it if I get it. And he wrote back, well, by hook or by crook, I hope you get the part. And I was like, oh my god, that response was amazing, and I'll tell you why later. And so then he called me on November 11th, and I was like, and I just found out that I got the part, and I said, I was just about to call you, because I got that part that I was telling you. And he goes, I was just calling you because it's the anniversary of Mary Kay's passing, and I just wanted to say hi and see how you're doing. And I was like, I was just like, oh my god, this was such a her thing. Like, I'm sure she has a career. So, anyway, just to be really weird, I just want to be just kind of creepy.
It's very homegrown. Something that a lot of people constantly ask voice actors is, oh, is there a part that you would like to play? And a lot of times that's asking you, do you want to take your best friend's job?
Yes.
Would you really?
Yes. Yes. I always get
credit for playing Raven, which I don't play, but I'm like, you're welcome. She's kind of like, maybe.
Yes.
But I did Mandy, and people always think that she did Mandy. She's just like, it's fine, I give credit for playing Mandy all the time, too. So like, him, Raven's on the air all the time, so.
So taking it less specific, more generic, what kinds of parts would you like to do more of? Would you like to do more musical stuff? Would you like to do more of a particular kind of character? Or even within a particular genre, stuff that maybe you grew up loving that you've gotten to do a whole, I mean, you've done a lot of work. You've got a great resume. But there's always something that you want to do a little bit more.
I would love to do more of those Studio Ghibli movies, but I'm not sure if they're closing down or not. They said that they're closing down, but there's some new things coming out. So I got to do that when Marnie was there, and that was like a fluke because there was a big celebrity in my part, and I kind of came in at the last minute. So if you look at the cast, it's like, I think I'm the only person that nobody's ever really heard of, or just like the only voice person. Because I was like, oh my god, John C. Reilly's playing my husband, and Kathy Bates is in this, and oh my god, you know,
I worked with Kathy Bates.
All these like Academy Award winners, and then this voice actress. But I came in like the day before, they, you know, I think the guy said, I know of an actress who could be probably do this, and I can call her right now, and she can come here right now. So we call, and it's like, can you be in the studio? And I was like, sure. And then I'm dubbing it, and I'm looking at the animation, and I'm like, wait a minute, is this what I think it is? And they're like, yeah, in the Studio Ghibli, and I can't believe it. And then they had me come back to redub only yesterday, that came out later. Had come out and never been dubbed.
Yeah, it had never been released in the States. Yeah. It came out in 91. It was one of these great Studio Ghibli movies that we just never got officially. Fell off of a truck or two. But the official release of it looks gorgeous, sounds gorgeous. The cast on it is phenomenal, just like all of these things.
Yeah. So, anyway, I'd love to do more of those. I would love to go to Japan and see the studio. Musical stuff would be fun too, but I have a very distinct, I did folk music for so long, like when I sing, I sound like me. It's hard for me to sing like, I don't know, I guess I sing like Daphne a lot, you know. I did get Black Canary, but I still sound kind of like me when I did, if only he would know me. You know, I just, it still sounds like how I sing. Yay, he's a Meister, I love him. I never got to meet Neil Patrick Harris, so I see him at cons and I'm like, we worked together, it was a big hit.
Got a couple more for you. We'll turn it over to the audience, give the rest of the time to the wonderful people who are here. Everybody enjoying themselves so far? Now, the world of voice acting, you find yourself paired with a lot of the same people when you have the opportunity to do group reads. As I understand it, this is becoming less and less the thing where there are a bunch of you in the studio together all at once.
Celebrities so much, and celebrities
stupid
are busier than us. Yeah, you know, we're used to our core group of people, but the more and more shows where most people are celebrities, I hardly see my cast members because they're all like all world shooting things.
When it comes to folks that you have done those kind of group radio theater type of recordings with, who are some of the people that you find yourself the closest with that are, you know, just your best pals that you love? When there is the opportunity to be in the studio together, you still love recording with them because you have no idea, you know, what kinds of, I guess you would say, mischief you'll get up to.
Yeah. Well, Tom Kenny and his wife are two of my closest friends. And now his wife, Jill, is playing our mom on The Loud House. So, and we just beat them in the ratings, like, because nobody ever beats SpongeBob. SpongeBob's been, like, number one forever. So, Jill was like, I went home and I was like, but yeah, so they're my real difference, and I hang out with them socially a lot. She's threw me my baby shower, which is great. And then also, Kate Micucci, who is the new Velma. When she started doing Velma, I wrote her on Twitter, because I just happened to, we should follow each other on Twitter. I was like, I'm going to write her a creepy, like, note about how much I like her, and then I was like, that's so weird. Like, I sent it, and I was like, no, I was sending it, and I was like, I can't get rid of it. No, it's just there.
I love this Daphne creeping on Velma.
I know! Best friends now. I feel like we are. But we just have such good chemistry, so I remember like, I just love working with you, and you're such a wonderful person, and I just feel so close to you already. I don't know, I hope this, you know, and then it was like, she didn't see it for a while, so I was like, it hasn't been checked. She's not like, but then she wrote it really sweet, like, oh my God, I feel the same way. And now we're like, we talked like several times a week. We have tacos, we need a taco, so I can talk to you about what's going on in my life. When she was dating, you know, she would tell me about all of her nightmare, Tinder things, and I would tell her about my marriage.
And the whole concept of Tinder still terrifies me. Now, also in the world of voice acting, one of the unsung hero roles I find often is the voice of, we were talking about mutual friend of Chris and Trey Romano.
Oh my gosh.
Before we started up. Yes.
She just retired. She's so sad. We threw her, Lorraine Newman and me and Eric Bowser threw her this going away party for, you know, oh God, it was awful because she lost sight in one eye, which is why she's retiring. She's like, I might lose sight in the other eye. I want to see the rest of the world before that happens. So they were like, hey, great, we know you do stand-up. We want to do a roast. We thought it would be really funny if some of the guys that wrote a Comedy Central style roast for Friars Club style roast for, you know, Andreas. So I'm like, great. So I wrote all these like really mean jokes about online, like all. Like, Andrea, I'm here. Listen to the sound of my voice. Like, I went first. Oh, okay, yeah. I mean, and you're supposed to. It's supposed to be with love, but it was like brutal. And then everyone else was like, yeah, we decided to just kind of be nice. Or like, I just loved you, working with you forever, and you're so amazing. And I was like, oh my God, this is not happening. And since she opened the last slide in one eye, Lorraine was like, we're going to put eye patches on the table. Like, that was the a whole joke for the whole thing, but Lorraine just kind of, she said everyone was going to be wearing Google eye patches, but she kind of just like put them on the tables like unobtrusively where people were like, oh, what's that? I don't know. And then no one wore the eye patches, and I did a bunch of blind jokes. But my son met Mark Hamill. Well, you can tell my son wanted to be an actor too, because he went up and talked. He loves the brand. He's known her his whole life. But he was like, everybody's giving these tributes, and he had to go. He's like, well, I saw everybody else talking, so I thought I gotta go up there and say something. I was like, that's such an actor. It's like, I gotta say something. I can't leave a microphone when they're asking people to come up and say. Anyway, he met Mark Hamill, which we've met a couple times. But yeah, they had a really great conversation. Like, they talked for a really long time. My son didn't know anything. And so then Mark walked in and goes, is that guy's name Mark? And I was like. And he goes, why do I know that?
And I go, you know. Holding a conversation with Mark Hamill, and Mark doesn't allow everybody to do that.
He has a one-man Broadway show going on. I know, he's doing it, yeah, he's great. He's so interesting. I could listen to him talk all day. I love it. He always tells me, like, you're the best-dressed person in voiceover. And I was like, kind of a compliment, but not really.
What's the personality of a voiceover director do for a room? I mean, how does, you know, working with Andrea differ from working with, I don't know, you know, Charlie, or, you know, the various people that you find yourself on the other side of the glass from?
We're so lucky. This is like, and I hate to be like, you know, boring, like, actors, like, you know, it's like a sports interview where every interview is the same, like, we just go up there, you know, we just try our hardest, like, the team's really good, it's the same thing, you can plug it into any game.
I mean, Greg just, she gives it 110%.
Paid off. Yeah, I know. But yeah, I don't read, and also, like, sometimes people hate people in casts, like on camera things, and I know they hate each other, but they're like, I just everybody's so amazing, and you're so lucky to be working together. It's like, oh, boring. I want to hear about the jerks.
We spent 11 seasons hating each other.
Mickey Dolenz was mean to us. He came and did. You know Mickey Dolenz from the Monkees?
Oh.
I hope he's not mad, but he was like a total jerk. And it was funny. My friend Candy goes, before he was leaving, because he was so awful to us, she's like, Mickey, I want to tell you something. And he's like, yeah. And she goes, when I was little, we used to play Who Gets to Marry a Monkey, but the loser had to marry you.
Well,
I tell all, every time I have like a driver's name, I'm like, this is the meanest first name I've ever driven. Everybody says Jane Seymour. I've heard Jane Seymour like 3 times. One guy said that she left her Versace sunglasses in his backseat because she was so miserable and awful that he said, I normally would take them back to the person's hotel and like leave them at the desk. He's like, but I was like, I went home and I was like, darling, you just got this wonderful pair of Versace sunglasses to his wife. Thank you. Because they're Jane Seymour's, which is a horrible person. I got to eat at that Club 40, was it Club 42?
33.
Club 33, yeah, Disneyland, yeah. And it's like this restaurant, it's like a secret restaurant, where, and it's the only place in Disneyland where they serve alcohol because it's like the secret club, and you have to like know somebody or have like, your grandfather in, and I ended up getting in. And I loved it, but I had to ask the guy, like, I was like, who's the worst person you've ever waited for? And he was like, Jane Seymour made me cry. I also heard Brandy's not a nice person. Because you know they have those Disney guides that take people around, like, you know, and so I asked the guy, I was like, have you ever like had like a really person, and he said that Mike Myers wasn't very nice, but that his wife was really nice, and his kids were really nice. And I also said that Brandy was not nice. I know about jerks, so I'm not going to tell you everybody's nice or not. But a lot of it, okay, so what I was going to say is everybody's nice. There aren't really a lot of jerks. Everybody's, because you know what? If you're a jerk, you just don't work anymore. There's so many talented people, and everybody wants to do voiceovers, so if you even show one sign of not being great to work with, they're just like, oh, there's the next person in line. And you can sound, you know, they can do sound alikes. I've had people that are not very nice, and they'll have somebody just like match their voice and come in the next week and be like, oh, bye, jerk. But the directors, there's only like 6 or 7, and they're all phenomenal. Like, there's nobody that's not, and they've been doing it forever. Like, when someone leaves, like, like a Supreme Court justice or something. Once people do that, they just want to do it for their own.
Yeah, when I heard Rob Nelson was starting to do directing, I was like, a new justice has been elected to the High Court.
I have to say, I feel like I sucked for him. I had the only session that I felt like I was really awful. He hired me to do Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles that hasn't aired yet, but it was like a Christmas present gift where it was like, here, come and get, you know, a session fee to do like 4 lines or something, and I just some tours or something. But I just, it was Rob, and I wasn't expecting him to direct me, so I was like, what are you going to be doing
today. He's like, oh, no, you're going in there and I'm going to direct you. And I was like, wait, you're directing me? And he's like, yeah. And I'm like, oh, and I was just totally thrown off. Rob, and I'm used to him being here. And this is so weird. And I just, by the time my brain got around to realizing what was happening, I'd already sucked through the whole session. So I don't know. He might think I was fine. He helped me a lot. But I was like, well, you know, when you start to like, I'm not doing well, you know, then you can't do well because your brain's like, you're still not doing well. No, you're still not doing well. No, you're still.
I'm giving you a compliment. You can go into the green room and you can see Rob. You're like, oh, Rob, hi.
Yeah. And then I don't want to talk to him about it because then he's going to be like, oh, you're great. And then he's like, of course he has to say that, so I'm not going to ever mention it. Except on every panel I do.
We're going to turn it over to the audience. We've got someone right here waiting very patiently.
Hi. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Well, thank you very much, peasant. I appreciate it. Jocelyn. See, I did quite burn you alive. Let's see what your question is.
I love it.
Obviously, a show with like a devoted and like long-running fan base, not just covering what it's like to be a part of something that, you know, has, you know, this devoted fan base even after like 10 years after the show was, you know,
finished. It's crazy. I just started doing cons like maybe 5 years ago, and it's all because I have kids in private school in Los Angeles. but I didn't know that Azula was that popular. I had one headshot of myself, you know, and with no characters on it. And Tara was like, you should come to Florida, it'll be fun. We'll bump together. And I was like, okay. And I went, and I had my wife, and then they're like, wait, I looked up and I said, do you do Azula on Avatar? And I was like, I think so. I've never seen the series, I've never watched it, and I just didn't know. And so people like, and then word got out in the con, that was the only reason I made any money to get it. And I was like, oh, Azula thing. People really like her. But yeah, I cannot believe it. I talked to Dante, who I'm still super close with. We're both single now, so I'm like, oh, let's go out. That would be really weird, wouldn't it? He's single, yeah. So I'm like, we should have dinner. That would mess people up, I guess. Anyway, but
yeah.
I was like, we should definitely take a picture, though, at dinner. We should go to dinner. Put it on Twitter. Anyway, but I told him, we should do it. See, the thing is, we want to do a con where we can have like all of our friends, like all the Avatar people in one convention. Wouldn't that be awesome?
Yes.
I know a ton about my work with them all the time. But I was like, we've got an Avatar con. I was like, oh no, then the blue people would show up and be upset.
And then you call it the last con vendor, you think you're walking into something totally different.
Oh.
They everybody get into trash.
Well, I said also we can't call it vendor con because all of you drama people will be pissed off. So I was thinking, like, we could do it like,
But now it's under NDA because it's going to be a thing.
It might be a thing.
Cool.
Hi. Hello. I have two boys over there, and they have watched you Wubsie.
Wow, you guys.
I can't tour because my kids, but I got to do the singing Catwoman for the Gotham by Gaslight. Did anybody see Gotham by Gaslight? I played the singing Catwoman, and I also said, sister, listen to the lady who, the old nun, you know, who gets murdered, but he was a good, he was a fine, sure. But I was very, very territorial. The other Catwoman, the woman who they had voice of Catwoman, we did a panel together, and I kept answering all the Catwoman, and I was like, oh yeah, you're Catwoman, I'm sorry.
Go right ahead before I expire on stage.
Hi, Gray. I'm sorry, I must be a little bit nervous, but first of all, I just wanted to say thank you so much for giving me so much of my childhood. You've voiced so many people that I've absolutely adored. And I just wanted to ask, have any time when you've been recording with your voice acting and stuff, since you do so many voices, has there been any times you've accidentally done like a different voice than the character you're voicing?
Yes.
Sometimes they bring you in and they have you do multiple voices in one session sometimes.
Oh, all the time. That's the reason people are like, I'm great at everything. People, I read the comments.
yes, she's watching.
No, but it's because they're cheap and they want to get as many voices as they can for one price. And they can keep for one price for up to three voices. So there are people that I've met out on the street who are like,
they just naturally kind of talk like this. Like, I always love to do voiceovers.
And I'm like, oh, poor thing. That's really tough. And I was like, maybe they'll get a part once in a while, but if they can't do anything but that voice, not often, you know? So that's why. That's why I do a lot of things, because I can save the money. But,
are
you cosplay right now? Are you cosplay? What are you dressed as?
I'm
King
Dyson Cuphead. My jacket's over there.
Oh, I love it. Okay, you
kind of
look like cosplay, so I'm
just gonna go. Go to bed, Victim Milkshake. But if you're 50 and you guys just like, you're yelling at everybody all the time, and then you kind of get quieter, and then 50 gets really sleepy, and then gets really serious, and she kind of turns into a man. Here. And the man who started like listening to rock and roll music, and she's like, "Come on, dudes, come on!" And then she's like, "Yumi from Buffy the Vampire Yumi."
And so it's like those three voices are very similar, and I kind of drift into them sometimes when I'm trying to do.
I just had a really mortifying experience down at the table because I was doing this girl came up to get a Sam sign, you know, Dan from Danny Phantom, and I was like, "Oh, awesome! You just you like you just Danny Phantom, all your goth chick, I can tell you got goth hair going on." And I'm talking, and she's like, "Oh my god." Like, and then Simon was like, "Can you do the voice of Sam?" And I was like, "I've been doing the voice of Sam." And I was like, "Oh, I guess I just haven't been doing it very well." I was like, "Maybe I got one myself." And then I pretended like I started to really do something. I was like, "Go, go, sir, and I'm really good." And I was like, "Oh, anyway." There was a comedian that was in some celebrity golf tournament, and he was just talking about how, like, he was not that famous of a comedian. I'm not going to say who it was, even though I love him, but he said that he was like, he met his people that had, like, paid all this money to, like, golf with some celebrity, and he's waiting and everything with them, and they go, "So do you know who our celebrity's going to be? I wonder who it's going to be." And they thought it was all the other people golfing, and he was like, "Oh no, I'm going to have to tell them I'm their celebrity, they don't know me."
You're developing a sitcom right here on stage. Next up.
Hello, this is Manuel. My question for you worked on Spectacular Spider-Man with Josh Keaton.
Yeah.
And like the season sadly didn't continue, but do you know like what would have happened to your character in season 3?
I played that asshole who's that really mean kind of like the cheerleader, you know, she was always like Peter Parker, oh yeah.
That sounds like Family Guy mom or something.
You were telling me that she in the comics she became like a bluebird, she had like a secret identity or something?
Oh, I think I believe so. Anyone can correct me, I could be wrong there.
I told him that she probably would become a prom queen.
Because of my great influence as well, my, my classmates, and because I've threatened them into it.
I have a funny story about that show because I really wanted to be Mary Jane, and I got down to me and Vanessa Marshall, who I adore, who played, who was on Grim Adventures of Billy and Mandy. She played my love interest with the little glasses, the little black boy with his name. What?
Erwin, yes, she was Erwin. Anyway, but
she's really this beautiful redhead who should be Mary Jane. But we were up against each other, and I'd gotten a few things over her in the past, so I was like, oh, you know, we're up against each other again. So she ended up getting it, and I was happy for her, but I was a little bit like, oh, I really wanted to play that on the show. But I did, in the very first episode, I did like one line as that Sally Avro character, and everybody laughed because I kind of like added some funny things that she said. She was just kind of brutal, mean girl.
And then they put me in the next episode, and then they put me in the next episode, and then they put me in the next episode. And I ended up being in like almost every episode of the season, and Mary Jane only showed up like 3 times.
Oh.
I was like, oh, great! You know, I'm sorry, I just like that little cheerleader kind of took on a life of her own. But she's supposed to have like one line in the first episode, not really be like a lot, but when you add funny things, punch up. I was telling them, but when you're auditioning, try to put like funny things in your auditions because they'll hire you because you'll make their show funnier. That's probably why I get some things, so I'm always trying to add jokes. Some people might be offended, like, we're comedians, we're writers, we just love the acting, we're the writers.
Have your guilt be
there was one time when the actor was like, "Greg, can we get it one time as, like, an it is on the page.
I guess it means.
I know. They want it to suck, but yeah.
So, wait, man, look at the shirt on this one.
And Jeepers, hi there.
Hi, my name is Kimberly. I've been a long time fan. I love everything you do.
Aww.
My question is, out of everything you play, I'm sorry.
Sometimes you gotta hear it.
I remember you.
Like I said before, I'm a big
play a big part of my childhood. I used to watch a lot of your shows, like my personal favorite character for you.
Kitty Castle just sounds like me, kind of, pretty much. Like, Dudley, what are you doing? Sounding a little bit like that.
What was your experience on that show like?
Tough Puppy was the best, most fun.
You know what actors say? They have a really fun time shooting something, usually it tanks. Like, the movie doesn't do well. They had a great time, but nobody ever sees the movie.
That's how I feel with Tough Puppy. Like, I felt like it should have been, it was so funny. Like, the writing is hilarious. I mean, there's stuff I still joke about. I mean, I still think about laugh, like the donut touch. Like, it said, do not touch on the donut plate, and then he's like, touching it. What are you doing? He's like,
donut touch.
I love playing, I played
Snapcraft's
mom on that.
She kind of had a voice that
sounded
like that.
I love that. And I didn't even get paid any extra for it. There were other actors that auditioned for it, but I was like, but I really want to, they were like, I want to audition for Snapcraft's mom. But like, we're not going to pay you any extra. I was like, I know, but I get to be Snapcraft's mom. So I took that money away from that other actor. But yeah, no, that was my favorite recording experience forever. We still have these hilarious text chains with Jerry Traynor, who was on iCarly for a long time. He was Dudley Puppy, and Darren Norris, who plays Cosmo on Fairly Odd Parents, and Maggie Taylor, and we all still joke around. Rob Paulson and Jeff Bennett, we all still like write to each other on this hilarious text chain. Every time it starts up, we keep joking about Jerry, because he's working and everything, but we joke about like that he's never going to work again because he's not on iCarly anymore. And so I was trying to make dinner plans, and then he's like, I can't do it. I'm working. And I was like, oh, I'm glad you picked up a shift. And I was like, we're all going to break. Yeah, that was really fun recording. That was my favorite.
Oh, boy, do we have a kid question up next? Kid questions are the best questions.
Why are you so mad?
Would you do the voice of Poppycorn?
You should do the voice of Poppycorn because you're adorable.
Poppycorn sounds a lot like this. He has a big sister named Moody Kitty. He gets in a lot of trouble because he's just a puppy. He doesn't know.
That was such a saga. I'm so excited that I got onto that show. And if you haven't seen it, it's called Moody Kitty. It's on Warner Bros. It's awesome. Tara Strong plays my sister. And I had the part, and then I lost the part. They were like, we're gonna go in a different direction. I think they might audition a real kid. And then my kid got this audition for my part. Like, my son texted me. Like, oh, that's great. So, crossing out all those. He won't ever read this reaction, you know. But he did a good job. And then they gave it to Jessica DeChico, who plays my sister on The Loud House, and I was glad that she was pregnant. And I was like, oh, but then I was like, but that anyway, good job though. And so then we were both up for, I have been playing the voice of Petunia Pig, not Petunia Pig, Petunia Pig, I was the voice of Petunia Pig for many years. And then she got that, but I got Peppercorn back. So she was like, I have bad news, I got Petunia Pig. And I was like, that's all right, they can cast me as Peppercorn now, I was afraid to tell you, so.
It's okay.
Yeah, so
she's
like, but mine only was like a couple episodes and yours is like a whole show. But, you know,
I'm
sorry, Jessica.
So great. I've got bad news and I've got good news. Bad news is we're pretty much at the time.
Oh.
The good news is crazy the rest of the weekend, right?
I am, and I'm taking a lunch break right after this, but I will be at my table at 3:00 if anybody needs anything signed or pictures.
So again, show of hands, who hasn't gone to see Gray down the autograph hall yet? Well, shame on you, first of all. Second of all, you can make up for the shame.
Probably safer to say 4 because the person who is handling me, and you can come at 3, you might not, but the person handling me, she really wants to get a picture taken with Jason Momoa, and I was like, she's like, oh, she's like, my picture time is at the time, and I was like, don't get a picture taken, don't worry about it. She could have been his, they offered her his, yesterday they said, hey, do you want to switch from Gray to Jason, and she, you know, I would not have been mad. But anyway, so.
Everybody saw him in the shirt on the Justice League,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, so I said, I would not have been mad, but she said, don't want to let Graham stay with Gray. Also, have you noticed he's walking around with like his own soundtrack music? Have you seen him? He walks through the our little area back there. You know, and he had like his own sound. He had an entourage and like a soundbox playing. He is. I don't know if anybody saw that, but it's weird. Like, I was in the middle of the story, and I was like, him while carrying his own sack. But he's probably lovely, and I'm really close friends with Creed Summer. I hope that he's married to her friend, and I'm sure he's very lovely, but I just thought that was kind of cool.
So if you don't go to Tinkering Table, you have absolutely missed out. I'm so glad you were all here with us in this room. We've got great maybe one or two of you, or a dozen of you have seen
Beauty
and the Beast.
She's going to come right now. She's
wonderful. We've got Marvel Chief Creative Officer Joe Quesada after her at 6 o'clock, and I'm hosting something called a Sing-Along with Jodie Benson, which I think utterly terrified, but at the same time, thrilled. So come see our programming. If you enjoyed this panel, let them know. If you enjoyed Gray, let them know. Please let them know everything that you like, and you know, anything that you don't like, I'm sure. But one thing that I do love is getting a round of applause for our talent. One last time.